Hi, this is Graham and I do hope everyone's having a great day. This video is the result of several requests by people to go over again the manual focus process, how to set up cameras like the FZ150 or the FZ200 to use manual focus, how do you engage it, and how actually do you set the focus with the controls available on these cameras. In addition to the section on manual focus procedure, I'm going to include a section on how to use these close-up lenses, as again there have been several requests to show how to use close-up lenses with the 150 and 200 cameras, as again people seem to be struggling in getting decent results by understanding how these lenses work in conjunction with the camera main lens. So I'll show you some practical demonstrations of how to use these lenses with some various size subjects, so you can get an idea of the field of view with the camera lens plus the number 1, number 2 or number 4 diopter, and you can see the type of results that you can expect with these lenses under the best possible imaging conditions. So let's get started. Let's have a look first of all at the manual focus procedure, how to engage manual focus and how to change the manual focus point and the focus area. So let's now look at setting this camera up for manual focus. The first thing to be aware of is the fact that manual focus is not enabled in the intelligent auto mode. So if I try to slide the side switch from the autofocus setting to the manual focus setting, you notice the camera displays a warning sign to say that manual focus is not available in the recording mode. So it's only available in the semi-automatic PAS or M mode, so you can only use those modes for manual focus, unfortunately. I want to use aperture priority, so I'm going to use the top control dial to turn to the aperture priority mode, indicated by the A on the LCD. And I want to set my aperture to about f6.3 to give me enough depth of field to cover this little model. As soon as you change into aperture priority mode, the camera is smart enough to put you in control of the aperture with the top control dial. So as I now rotate the top control dial, you'll see that the aperture changes. And I want to go to f6.3, which is just a third of a stop up from where it was. But the top control dial controls the aperture. So I'm going to go for f6.3. Now press the top control dial in. I've now changed the operation from manual focus to, at the moment, exposure value compensation. And if I press it in again, you'll see that it changes back to aperture. And if I press it in again, you'll see that it goes back to manual focus. For manual focus to work, this icon must be yellow, and I think that's one of the stumbling blocks for new users. They forget to enable manual focus by switching to the manual focus mode. Now when I turn the top control dial, you'll see along the bottom we have a focus scale come up. So I'll just move the dial one click to the right and you can see that the focus dial comes up. Along the bottom you can see the focus scale. And dependent on the region, you may have meters or feet here. And this, in my instance, goes from 0.01 of a meter to infinity. I've got the camera on full zoom. So at the moment, the minimum focus distance with this lens is 1 meter. And that's from the sensor to the subject. So I can't go any closer than 1 meter. You notice that as I move the control dial, you will see the image changing on the LCD, and you can see that it just comes into focus just short of 1 meter. You notice that the image is also magnified. When this scale disappears, you'll see we've got the full image. When I move the top control dial, I get a magnified image. And that's because in the menu, I've got what's called manual focus assist turn on, and that gives you this enlarging option. And it's a two-stage process. The first stage gives you the first degree of enlargement, and if I press it again, I can get to a second degree of enlargement to give me even finer control of where I see the focus. To change the position of the manual focus target, I have to be first of all in the manual focus mode, so that means that I'm adjusting the focal point, and then I use the menu set to allow me to change the position. So if I move the dial one click to the right, that brings me into the manual focus mode. Then I press menu set, and that gives me the option now to change this target area. Using the four-way navigation buttons, I can now move the position of this cursor to where I want, and in this case, I want it over the face of the model. When I'm happy with that, press the menu set again, and that immediately brings me back into the focus mode, and you can see the area that's now been used for focus is the target area that I defined. And I can now check the focus by looking at the screen. And if I wanted a closer focus, again, just press the button in one more time, and that gives you the super magnified view of the focus point. Ideally, it's better to go through the focus to the point of focus and out again, just to check that you've got the correct position for the focus. And after the timeout, you'll come back to the image taking screen.
Let's now look at using close-up lenses with the Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras. And I've got a setup here where I want to take a photograph of this porcelain doll. The actual doll is about 100 millimeters high, 4 inches high, and I want to take a head and shoulder portrait of the little doll. At the moment, there's no close-up lenses on the camera, and I've got it as close as I can to get the head and shoulder shot. And at the moment, from the front face of the lens to the model is 8 centimeters, or about 3 inches. The problem I've got at the moment is trying to get sufficient light into the model without the lens shading the actual model itself. I've got a light set at 45 degrees to the subject, and I've got a small metallic reflector on the right hand side just to throw back some light into the shadows to even up the contrast. I've got the camera set up for aperture priority, and at the moment I'm using an aperture of f5 and an ISO of 100. I'll take this first image so we can have a look at the quality with the camera set to wide angle position and this close range. You might notice in the background I've got another model which is acting as an indicator for the amount of depth of field that the camera is showing. Obviously, the smaller the aperture, the more depth of field you've got, or conversely, the larger the aperture, the shallower depth of field. So first of all, I'll change the aperture to f2.8, and again, because the aperture is marked in yellow, it means the top control wheel has control of the aperture setting. So if I turn this now down to f2.8, and we retake the shot, you can see that the image at the background is more out of focus, indicating that we have a shallower depth of field. I'll repeat this at f8 just to show you the total range of depth of field at this close distance. So again, I'll adjust the aperture to f8 and we'll take the picture. And I think you can see that the little doll in the background is much more in focus. If you were outside and wanted to take pictures of flowers, you could probably get away with this setup. But if you wanted to take pictures of insects, you probably wouldn't be able to approach this close without them flying off. So you need to find some way of moving the camera back, yet maintaining the image size. The only way you can do that is to zoom in. And of course, that's an acceptable process. So I could move the camera back. I'm going to move the camera back now. And to try and maintain that image size, I'm going to zoom in slightly. So the camera is struggling to focus now as I'm applying more zoom, and we're just under ×3 optical zoom, and at the moment the lens to subject distance is 7 inches, or that's 180 millimeters for metric users. And again, we'll take this picture again by trying to include that little doll in the background to give an indication of depth of field. And first of all, we're taking the image at f8. And then I'll reduce this to f2.8. So I've now moved the camera further back, and to try and get this same composition, the camera's given me the familiar range warning that I have to be within 0.6 of a meter for the camera to focus. So at this point, the addition of close-up lenses saves the situation. And you can use the number 1, the number 2, or the number 4 to give you the correct working distance you need to give you the subject size that you need. So let's look at the first lens, which would be the number 1, and the working ranges that you'll get if you attach the number 1 lens. I've now attached the number 1 close-up lens to the lens on the Panasonic Lumix FZ200, and I've got currently about times 9 optical zoom on the camera, and the working distance I've got at the moment between the camera and the subject is about 24 inches or 63 centimeters. So you can see we've appreciably moved the subject to camera distance and yet maintained the right image size on the sensor. Doing this also gives you the advantage that you can throw the background out of focus, which is especially useful if you want to highlight a particular subject against its background. At the moment I've got the camera set to f8, so we'll take that image and have a look at that, and you can see the amount of depth of field. And I'll adjust the lens now to give me f2.8. Again, we'll take that image. And I think you can see from that the image is now completely defocused. With the number 1 lens attached, the working range becomes 24.5 inches or 63 centimetres up to 45.5 inches or 116 centimetres. So you've got quite a good working range if you wanted to photograph things like insects. If I wanted to throw the background further out of focus, then I can move back to the maximum working distance with this lens, which would be 45.5 inches or 116 centimetres. And I'll do that now just to show you the amount of depth of field that you get. I've moved the camera right back now with the number 1 lens attached, and I'm at 45.5 inches away from the subject. And again, I've zoomed in to maintain the same sort of crop. And at the moment the camera is set to f8, and we'll take that image so we can look at the amount of depth of field. And I'll now adjust the lens to f2.8. And we should have a very, very shallow depth of field, which is ideal for this type of photography. You can see the background is very much defocused. I've now installed the number 2 close-up lens on the camera, and I've got a working distance of 20 inches or 50 centimeters, and you can see the image size is roughly the same. And I'm going to take this image with the camera, and we're at aperture of f8. And again, I'll adjust that to f2.8 so we can see the amount of depth of field with the number 2 lens attached. The working range of the camera with the number 2 lens is from about 18 inches, which is 46 centimetres, up to 24 inches, which is 63 centimetres. So again, you've got quite an appreciable working range with the lens. The number 4 lens is the next one I'm going to attach, and it's the strongest of the dioptres. It does give you a closer working range of between 13 inches or 33 centimetres up to 15 inches or 38 centimetres. So the range is a little more restricted, but you do get a higher magnification. I've now attached the number 4 close-up lens to the camera, and we've got a optical zoom of about times 3 on the camera, and again trying to maintain something like the same crop to give you an idea of the depth of field. At the moment I've got a working distance between the camera and the subject of about 11 inches or 28 centimeters, and I've got an optical zoom of about times 3 or times 4 on the camera. The image size is roughly the same. The aperture is at f8, so I'll take that shot to look at the depth of field with this setup. And now I'll change to f2.8. Again, you can see the background is nicely defocused. So using this table of the lens setups, you should be able to find a diopter and zoom condition which will give you the right image size for your particular shot. If you wanted to get super macro, then you need to use these times 10 lenses, but unfortunately they give you quite a lot of chromatic aberrations, that's colour fringing on the subject, and you also notice a lot of distortion around the outside edges due to the curvature of the glass. In my experience, the number one and number two lenses are the best lenses to use for this type of photography. Once you start to get to the times four, the additional amount of glass and curvature of that glass tends to give you these chromatic aberrations and a lot more out of focus around the outside edges of the frame. So I would limit your photography to the number one and number two, and that should cover most of your needs. To give you some idea of the fall off from the centre to the edge, I'm going to set up a shot with this number four lens attached, and you can see the amount of defocus from the centre to the edge. So this is the number four lens, and I've tried to keep the scale parallel to the camera back so that there won't be any distortion due to the fact that we're not parallel. So when I take this image at f2.8, you'll be able to see the amount of fall off to the outside edges of the rule and any loss of resolution. I'll now increase the aperture to f8. So that should improve the central sharpness and reduce the amount of fall off to the outside edge. I've now adjusted the zoom on the camera to maximum, and this is the number four lens. With the lens wide open, which you get in live view at the moment, you can probably see there is a fall off between the centre at the 15.5 position on the rule to the outside edges. With the camera stopped down to f8, that should improve the situation. I've now got the camera held on the focus point at halfway down, and you can see that the image resolution in the centre has improved and the outside edge is slightly improved. There is the evidence of chromatic aberration on the outside edges, and you'll see that in the final shot. If I take this image at f2.8, you'll appreciate the amount of fall off as you get closer with these lenses. To show you how bad the image is with a x10 macro lens attached to the camera, I've got the camera set now to full zoom and with the x10 lens set up, and you can see that the image size is only 5mm, so you do get a superb large image, but unfortunately the image resolution is bad and the fall off is bad and the chromatic aberration is also bad. So this is the live view at f2.8, and I think you can see that the centre has got quite a high contrast, and the outside edges, it's abysmal. If I stop down to f8, you can see the amount of chromatic aberration now that's been induced. Okay, the contrast has increased in the central areas, but the resolution is so poor that you could only use the centre portion of this image for a picture. So I'll take that and we can have a look at that in the final image. The image quality does improve as you reduce the amount of zoom, and at the moment I have about x7 zoom on the camera with the x10 lens attached. So you can see that we're down to the same sort of magnification as you'd get with the number 4 lens at a greater working distance. So the advantage you get with these lenses is actually overshadowed by the fact that you get so much distortion and chromatic aberration that they're not worth the money that you're paying for them. So here's the image at this magnification with the x10 lens. To recap then, if we want to set manual focus with these bridge cameras, we need to be in the PAS or M modes, as it doesn't work in the intelligent auto mode. We need to slide the switch on the side of the camera to the manual focus position. Notice the manual focus becomes active. We have the MF in yellow, which means this top control dial now will control the focus point. If I rotate the dial, we go into the focus mode and we get the focus scale, which shows us the distance the camera is focusing at. and by using the top control dial or by using the navigation keys, you can actually change the focus point. If you've got manual focus assist set in the menu, then you get an enlarged view of the image as you go into manual focus. If you wanted to change the position of the focus target, then you need to go into the manual focus mode again by just rotating the control and then press menu set, which allows you to use the four-way navigation buttons to change the focus point that you want to use for the critical focus. When you press menu set again, it takes you into manual focus assist, and again you can either use the cursor keys or the top control dial to enable you to set the focus point. When you've done that, you're free to take the picture.
Well, that's it for this video. I hope that did help to resolve some of the issues you have using manual focus and using close-up lenses with Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras. So until the next video, it's Graham saying thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you in later videos. Bye for now.